Okay, today we are going to discuss equity investment. Investment in equity instrument, which is share or stock. So by having shares, it indicates that the holder of the share has ownership in a particular company. And by having that share, the share give you right to acquire or to dispose the ownership interest. Means selling or buying the share represent the acquire the buying and selling of the ownership of the company that issued the share. And cost of purchasing a share include the price and also the broker's commission and fees related to the acquisition cost. However, to simplify the accounting process, the broker's commission and fees related to the acquisition cost, to the acquisition of the share, are recorded as expense in the period they are incurred. Jadi kalau biaya broker dan biaya fee ya lain-lain terkait perolehan saham dibebankan pada saat terjadinya, pada periode terjadinya. So we are going to record the investment as it price only. Why is that? Usually the broker's commission and fees are immaterial, are not significant. So they are quite cheap compared to the price of the stock. So we can expense directly the broker's commission and fees. Jadi karena ukurannya yang relatif kecil dibanding price-nya, jadi kita bisa langsung expense instead of capitalizing as part of the asset cost. Meskipun pada umumnya untuk acquisition cost, usually we capitalize the cost and include it in the asset cost. However, for this investment cost, if it is too small or if it is not material, then we can just expense the cost. Okay, related to the equity investment, we can divide into three categories based on the degree to which one corporation or investors acquires an interest in the investee. So the first class is small or little ownership. So if the investors have only less than 20% of the stock shares of the investee, then the ownership considered as small or little. So in that regard, there is no effect, there is no influence that investor has to direct the investee. So because the ownership is quite low, it is less than 20%, it is assumed that investor does not have any influence to the investee. So investors cannot direct the important decision made by the investee. Jadi kalau kepemilikan kecil, investors tidak punya kekuasaan untuk direct, untuk mengarahkan the investors' decision, keputusan-keputusan investi. So in that regards, we are going to use fair value. And later you we will see that there are two approaches or two methods in recording this ownership. First, we use fair value through profit loss if the equity investment is trading securities. Okay, like as I told you last week that the purpose of investment will determine the method that investor use. So if the investor has this investment as a trading securities, as a trading commodity, then the investor should use fair value profit loss method. Later we can see what does this method mean. And the second is fair value through OCI. It is equity investment but not held for trading. Okay. And the rest of the ownership degree, so after the first class, which is small holding or small investment. Then the second is between 20 to 50% and more than 50%. So for the second and the last class of investment, you will learn this in the next course in Advanced Accounting 1. So the whole semester Advanced Accounting 1 will discuss these two, as these two are too complex to be discussed in this intermediate accounting. So these two will be discussed later in Advanced Accounting 1. However, as you may also learn this in basic accounting, we're gonna see some basic approach, some basic procedures related to these two class. So in this chapter or in this course, we're gonna focus on this, the first class only. So if the company hold less than 20%, as I told you, there are two categories that investors can use to account the method. The first, if the investment held for trading. Jadi secara bisnis, as I told you last week, the business model determine how the company or how the investors handle the investment account. So if the investors acquire the stock and this acquisition and the stock are held for trading, memang dibeli untuk diperdagangkan. So the business model of the investment is trading. Then the investor should value its investment account using fair value, and any value adjustment in the end of the period, the difference or the adjustment will be recognized in the net income as part of profit loss. Okay. Other income that can be recognized is dividend or any gain or losses due to the sale of the investment. And the second method is non-trading option, means the equity investment is not set for trading. So investors purchase the stock not for trading. For example, it is for other reason, for like for liquidity reason. So instead of having too much cash in the company, then the investor can buy some stock and earn income from having that stock. And later they can sell when they need cash. So in that purpose, there is no specific purpose. There is no specific intention to trade the stock or to trade the investment. Jadi kalau di tujuan yang kedua ini, there is no specific tujuan yang benar-benar untuk trading. So mostly having this investment is for liquidity reason, to manage the liquidity level of the company. Having too much cash is not good for the company. Having less cash is also not good. So they have to manage the liquidity at an appropriate level. So if the company has too much cash and having too much cash is not good, because having too much cash will not give you any return, will not give you any additional return or income. So instead holding that cash, you can spend the cash to buy some investment and earn like dividend income or any other valuation income. And then when you need cash, then you can sell the investment. So if the purpose of investment is non-trading option, still you have to use fair value, but the adjustment, the valuation adjustment is not reported in the profit or loss. Instead, it is reported as part of the equity account. We call as other comprehensive income. If you remember chapter, if you remember like chapter 4 or chapter 5 in intermediate accounting 1, when you talk about, when you learn about income statement, in IFRS, we have two parts of income statement. The first part is profit loss, the bottom line is net income, and the second part is other comprehensive income. So please refer to the chapter intermediate accounting 1. So the first part will result net income, and the net income will be accumulated to the retained earnings. However, the second part is called OCI, and the total will be accumulated to accumulated OCI in the equity section of the balance sheet. Okay, so the rest, holding more than 20%, as I told you, we use equity method, and both of them use equity method, and it will be discussed later in advanced counting two. I'm sorry, advanced counting one. So let's focus on the first categories, which is holding less than 20%. So if the company hold less than 20%, then the presumption is that equity investment are held for trading. Jadi kalau kepemilikannya sedikit, itu asumsinya adalah the company or the investor has this investment for trading. Okay. Except there is another reason. Kecuali ada alasan lain. Jadi alasan utamanya pasti untuk trading, kecuali dibuktikan berbeda. So how, what is the general accounting and reporting rule? First, the investment valued at fair value. means each reporting date the investment should be adjusted to represent the current or the newest fair value. And then the realized gain or losses reported in the net income, the first part of net income statement. And if there is a reason and there is evidence that the investment is not for trading, okay, if there is enough reason and evidence that the investment is not for trading, then we still have to use fair value, wherefore the adjustment, the valuation adjustment is not recorded in profit loss, it is recorded as part of the other comprehensive income. So let's see this example. Suppose the company has three shares, and the investment, each investment representing less than 20%. And you can see the total cost of the portfolio, it is 700,000. So when the company buy this share, the company record investment on debit and credit cards. Okay. Because yeah, they spend cash to purchase the investment. And suppose on November 6, investors receive cash dividend for 4,200. And to record this, the investor simply debit cash and credit dividend income. Okay, I think it's nothing difficult up to this point. Okay, in the end of the reporting date, so in each reporting date, investors should adjust the investment value to represent the newest or the current fair value. Di setiap tanggal pelaporan, investors harus menyesuaikan nilai investasinya agar mencerminkan fair value of the shares. So according to the stock exchange data, this is the fair value of the shares according to the stock exchange. Berdasar data dari bursa, we can see that some shares, two shares, are decreasing, which is Nestle and Regis Pulp. The stock are decreasing. So we have to in the end we have to reduce the investment value due to this valuation adjustment. Jadi kita harus turunkan 718, kita turunkan 30.000. So we credit fair value adjustment and debit unrealized loss. Okay. Unrealized loss, and because this portfolio are for trading, the unrealized loss reported as part of net income, part of profit loss statement, and the fair value adjustment is used to adjust the value of the investment. So later we're gonna see that the investment value is no more 718,000. It will be deducted by 35,000. Okay. Suppose in the next year on January 23, one of the share, which is Burberry, is now sold, and the company, the investors receive 280,000. And the net profit is 287,000. However, the cost is 259 thousand. So the difference between the profit and the cost recorded as gain on sale. So we receive that cash, and then credit the equity investment. We dispose the investment, and then we record gain on sale. Personally, I have concern with this journal because we know that in the previous year, we record fair value adjustment related to this share price. And we still keep that fair value adjustment in our financial statement. Okay. So as you may see here, again, this is my personal viewpoint. It's not represent the book, the author viewpoint. So, okay. So it is verbally. So as you see that in the end of December 2019, Burberry contribute 15,000 unrealized gain, right? And fair value adjustment, positive 15,000. And we still keep that number in the fair value adjustment. And this fair value adjustment reported as part of the investment account, okay? Jadi fair value adjustment ini dilaporkan sebagai bagian dari investment account. Nah, ketika Burberry dilepas, so when Burberry is disposed, in my personal opinion, we should dispose this 15,000 as well. It is my personal suggestion. However, in this book, the author silent related to this 15,000. Jadi authornya tidak bicara mengenai 15.000 tadi. Biarkan saja. I think in chapter 10, when we talk about fixed asset, so if we have fixed asset and the related accumulated depreciation, and then we sell the fixed asset, we have to write off the accumulated depreciation as well, right? So kalau kita bicara fixed asset, when we sell the fixed asset, kita juga harus write off, kita juga harus hapus the related accumulated depreciation, ya kan? Akumulasi depresiasi yang terkait juga harus kita lepas, kita write off, kita hapus. However, in this case, in this investment case, we have the similar account called fair value adjustment. However, when we sell a particular shares, we don't write off the fair value adjustment. That will be my concern, my personal concern. And the author is silent. And authornya diam aja. Komentar soal. Okay, but my personal suggestion is not part of this course objective. Jadi, tujuan dari mata kuliah ini tidak termasuk komentar personal soal.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
I think that let's say this investment is not like the depreciation or accumulated depreciation as an asset, but because let's say when the company buy the other investment, so they'll directly insert or reduce or gain their, let's say the fair value adjustment of it. So I think that, is the point why they done it when they sell, let's say, the investment, the latest investment, and buy the other. So when there is a fair value in other, let's say the new investment, they'll directly, let's say, adjust it on that point. So
I got your point. So yes, I agree with you. The fair value adjustment is not right, is not written off, is not offset, is not written off, because it will be used to adjust a new stock that the investors buy. Okay, that's pretty good, that's pretty clear. However, still, personally, I don't agree with that approach. Again, as I told you before, that this fair value adjustment, I use metaphor of the accumulated depreciation or allowance for doubtful account or allowance for impairment loss. They are attached with the particular asset. So if the asset gone, then the attachment or the account related to that asset should be gone as well. But it's only my personal opinion. So I will have different approach to handle this fair value adjustment. Okay. However, as you may say that this fair value adjustment is still in the company, and the fair value adjustment will be used to adjust the next portfolio, the new portfolio. Okay. But again, the author keeps silent related to this account. And if I ask question, there is no answer from this book. So what if we sell all the portfolio? All the portfolio sold. So when and where the fair value adjustment will go? There is no explanation. Okay, but anyway, it is my personal comment. Okay, let's move on. So later, the company buy another share, which is Continental Trucking, and having these shares since February 10, 2020, and in the end of the reporting period, the total investment now increasing by 66,000. Okay, the carrying value is 713, and then the fair value is now 779. So the unrealized gain is 66,100. However, previously we have fair value adjustment with negative balance, which is 35,000. Okay, previous fair value adjustment balance, and it is negative or credit. So to make the fair value adjustment to be 66,000, we have to add 101,000. Okay. So again, this approach, I don't agree with this approach. Okay. So sorry for that. I don't agree with this approach, but anyway, I have to follow the book. So the author used this method. So we're gonna record debit fair value adjustment and credit unrealized gain for 101. Okay, so now let me explain my concern. Again, this is my personal comment, and this is not part of the learning objective. So my personal comment, I don't agree with this approach. because their yield market value adjustment is 66,100. The gain that the company deserves to record is 66,100. It is not 100,000. But because the author used this method, this method requires recognition of gain more than the real economic gain. Jadi metode ini membuat pencatatan gain-nya itu melampaui the real economic gain. That's my concern. However, on the other hand, when there is loss, then as the consequences, the company will record higher loss than the economy, real fact of the loss. Jadi, kalau gain-nya cuma 66, tapi di sini gain-nya menjadi 101. And unfortunately, you have to pay tax based on this number. So the tax concern will hit the company. Jadi lebih parah. But in my approach, I will not. So let me tell you why I have that approach, why I have this concern, because I see transition between our previous accounting standard and this IFRS. So I know the transition. In the past, we don't use this approach. In the past, when the fair value increase, then we're gonna adjust the carrying value of the carrying value of the stock. So in the previous year, the carrying value is not the cost. The carrying value from previous year is 304,000. And 104. So in the past, we used this approach. So we don't use the cost at all. We record the cost at the acquisition date, and then every year we adjust the carrying value to the fair value. Jadi langsung aja kita sesuaikan ke carrying value-nya, tidak pakai akun fair value adjustment. Nah, sekarang pendekatan yang dipilih adalah fair value adjustment, okay? Tapi ini membuat pengakuan gain dan loss-nya menjadi bias, in my opinion. Okay? But anyway, we have to use this approach. Later you will discuss this topic in accounting theory course, not in this course. Okay, so far this is what we have in equity investment for trading. So if the investments is not for trading, it's not for trading, then the only difference is when do we recognize unrealized gain or loss. So we do recognize unrealized holding gain or loss in other comprehensive income part of the equity section. That is the only difference. And the rest is the same as trading investment. Yang lain sama kecuali Relation thinking itu contohnya di ekuitas. So, let's see this example. The company purchased investment with total cost $20,000, and the investment represent less than 20% of interest. Okay, and the company, the investee. Is a distributor for the investor. Okay. And the loss of which require a minimum level of share ownership of a company in that region. Jadi, kadang ada aturan yang mengharuskan kepemilikan saham. Ya, memang saham the shares is purchased not for trading, it is only for complying the law. Okay, there is no trading motive in behind the investment. So the investment meets this regulatory requirement, and this is not for trading. That's why the company still has to use investment at fair value. So the investment recorded as this. And later, in the end of the, okay, when the investee pay dividend and the company or the investor receive the dividend revenue or dividend income. And then later in the end of the year, the company should adjust the fair value of the share. So the adjustment is 3,250. And recorded as part of the unrealized holding gain. So, see this example. See this account. Instead of using fair value adjustment, in this part, they directly debit investment account. Right? So, the equity investment account is used because the non-tracking classification is applied on investment by investment basis rather than on a portfolio basis. Jadi karena ini alasan penulis ya, ini alasan autornya, Pak Kiesu dan kawan-kawan. They argue that they use equity investment because we treat this investment as an individual basis. Jadi mereka memperlakukan investmentnya pada level individual, bukan pada level portofolio. Kalau tadi diperlakukan pada level portofolio, sehingga any adjustment is recorded in fair value adjustment account, and they don't use the equity investment directly. Okay. Is it part of the standard or not? In my opinion, this is not part of the standard. This is the interpretation that author use. Okay. Menurut pendapat saya, ini adalah interpretasi author terhadap standar, bukan standar itu sendiri. However, the standard give you opportunity to do accounting at an individual investment account or at portfolio level. It is up to you. Jadi sebenarnya standarnya memberi kebebasan apakah diperlakukan pada level portfolio atau pada level individual. Tapi buku ini mungkin memberikan contoh untuk yang trading investment kita pakai portfolio with reason, for example, we have so many investment accounts, so we cannot do the adjustment one by one following the numbers of investment. So instead doing that, we can use portfolio. portfolio level to simplify all the process. However, to simplify the adjustment process is doesn't mean that it is a correct way. Kan? Selalu ada cost benefit. Kalau kita treat investmentnya pada individual account, butuh teknologi yang biaya yang lebih untuk bisa merecord pergerakan saham pada level individual. Kan? Tapi kalau kita perlakukan pada level portofolio mungkin lebih mudah. Mungkin. Jadi, then the author give you two approaches or two options. Whether you treat as an individual level like this, by debiting directly to the equity investment, or you treat your investment at portfolio level by using fair value adjustment. It's up and it depends on the company needs. Jadi terserah kebutuhan perusahaan. Okay, after doing that adjustment, then we can see this account on the financial statement, on the statement of financial position, we see equity investment after adjustment. And then on the equity section, we can see accumulated other comprehensive income, the previous unrealized gain. And then on the income statement, we recognize the dividend revenue and the second part of the profit loss is other comprehensive income. On that part, we have this unrealized gain. Okay. So on December 20, in the next year, the investor sell all of these share at 22,500. So the loss is 1,500. So when the investor sell this investment, then the investor record cash on debit for 22,500, and then credit the equity investment, which is 24,000, and the difference will be recorded as So before selling the investment, the company should adjust the fair value of the investment. So as you can see here, the unrealized gain or the unrealized loss is 15,000, sorry, 1,500 or 1,500. So before selling that investment, the company adjusts the value by crediting the investment and debiting the unrealized loss. And then later, the company will sell the investment at fair value, and there is no gain or loss from the selling. There is no gain or loss from the selling. If you read the book, the author said, recognition of the sale does not result in a gain or loss because the equity investment is stated at fair value. Note that all gains and losses on the non-trading investment are recorded in equity. Once non-trading equity investment are sold, companies may transfer the balance of unrealized holding gains or losses in accumulated other comprehensive income to retained earnings. Transferring the balance to retained earnings has merit as these gains or loss would have been recorded in net income in a prior period if the securities were accounted for as trading securities. So, why there is no gain or loss from selling of this investment? Because, sorry, so after this, there will be another entry. There will be another entry to move the balance of unrealized gain or loss in the equity section to the retained earnings section. Jadi yang ini nih, this one is accumulated in this account, accumulated other comprehensive income. Okay. When it is sell, when the investment is sold, then we're gonna move this balance to the retained earnings. Jadi setelah dilepas, baru dipindah ke retained earning. Yeah. However, kenapa dipindah ke retained earning ya? Karena dia udah nggak kita kuasai dan dia sudah kita jual. Jadi ya, apa yang ada di equity sebagai accumulated other comprehensive income itu sekarang sudah realized, ya kan, sudah terrealisasi menjadi keuntungan yang kita jual, menjadi keuntungan from the selling. However, International Accounting Standard Board, IFRS, and also Indonesian Accounting Standard Board, they do not allow this transfer. So the transfer of accumulated other comprehensive income from unrealized holding gain or loss, investasi non for trading, ini nggak boleh. So you can see the debate now. There are many debates in this standard. Jadi harusnya kalau itu sudah dijual, sesuatu yang disimpan di ekuitas dengan nama other comprehensive income itu sudah dijual, itu namanya sudah realized. When we realize, then we have the opportunity to move this accumulated other comprehensive income into the retained earnings. Karena kita akhirnya sudah dapat uangnya. However, the accounting standard board does not allow this transfer. Does not allow this transfer. Tidak boleh di transfer. So, the realized gain, ya kan? Kan sudah realize ini ya. Kalau masih investmentnya masih dipegang, kemudian nilainya naik turun, itu kan unrealized gain, tapi yang nggak realize, yang nggak faktual menjadi hard cash gitu misalnya, itu unrealized. Ya ketika dijual kan harusnya sudah realize. Nah ketika sudah realize, pindah dong ini ke retained earning. Ya, tapi accounting standard tidak mengizinkan itu. Okay, that part of the debate. Anyway, it is it's a debate still. We have to follow the accounting standard for sure. Meskipun kita nggak cocok. So if you back to the chapter 1 and chapter 2, then you find there is a political consideration in setting up a standard. Di ada pertimbangan politis juga. Ya, seperti ini kan, pada akhirnya we have to decide which approach that we're going to use. So when you decide it, if these two approaches are conceptually correct, conceptually reasonable, then you have to make a choice to choose one. And what will be the reason? The reason is the political cost. Which approach that costs less to the investors, to the preparer of the financial statement. Karena, back to the previous slide, so if we have to move this accumulated other comprehensive income to the retained earnings, Anda harus bayangkan betapa ribetnya pencatatan di company, and accumulated other comprehensive income, they have to have like subsidiary ledger gitu kan. Mereka harus punya buku besar pembantu ini, other comprehensive income dari investment yang non for trading. Ini other comprehensive income dari investment yang mana? Ini other comprehensive income dari revaluation surplus of fixed asset. Ini other comprehensive income dari mana-mana. Lalu kemudian mana yang bisa di-recycle ke retained earning, mana yang tidak bisa di-recycle ke retained earning. It will create complexity in accounting. So to avoid that complexity, then you do not need to recycle the retained earning. Keep it in accumulated other comprehensive income forever. So mungkin one of the reason behind this approach. Okay, for the next level of investment, which is holding more than 20%, we're gonna use equity method. So equity method is actually quite simple. In equity method, the cost of investment is adjusted by adding this with net income of investing. Okay. Investors' proportionate share of the earnings or losses, jadi cost of investment-nya ditambah atau dikurangi sebesar proporsi share atau bagian investor terhadap laba atau rugi investi, and then deduct this cost investment with the dividend received by the investors. Okay, let's see an example here. So first of all, when the company buy the share, I think the recording is the same. You debit the investment credit cash. Okay, and then in the end of the year, the investee reported net income of 200,000. So in the equity method, the investors has the right to recognize 20% of that net income as an investment income or investment revenue, which is 40,000. Jadi investor berhak mengakui secara proporsional laba investi sebagai pendapatan investasi dia, investor. So you get the equity investment, you increase the equity investment, and you record the investment income. Why do we debit the equity investment? So equity method treat the investment as part of your asset. So if your asset increase due to its economic performance, then you have to increase, you have to adjust your asset value. For example, if you treat this as a metaphor, for example, you have saving account in a bank. If someone transfer some money to your account, then you have to recognize that your account balance increasing due to that transfer. So similarly with this, when investee work and they record profit in the end of the year, then you have to recognize that my asset in that company increase because they are now earn some profit. Okay? Karena investee sudah bekerja mendapat keuntungan, maka harta saya yang ada di investee itu harus saya akui meningkat. Okay, and in the end of the year as well, the fair value of the share is now, I think it increased from 10 to 12. So previously the share was $10 per share and now $12 per share, so the value increased. But in equity method, we don't recognize that valuation adjustment. When the company receives dividend, the company will credit the investment. The reason behind, again, you have to treat this investment as your asset, as your money. Jadi kalau di perusahaan investee, so if the investee give you dividend, then your asset managed by investee now decrease because they are paying dividend. Jadi ketika investee membayar dividend kepada Anda, you receive the cash, but your asset, kekayaanmu yang dipegang oleh investee, menurun nilainya karena dibayarkan dalam bentuk dividend. So you have to reduce, you have to deduct the equity investment. Okay, so what if the investee recorded loss? So similarly, then your asset managed by the investee decrease due to this loss. So you have to decrease or you have to deduct the investment equity. And fair value adjustment, there is no entry. Okay. For having more than 50% of investment, I mean the last class is having more than 50%. Okay. If the company, if investors have more than 50%, they have to use the same approach, which is equity method, plus they have to make what we call as consolidated financial statement. So, yes, so parent, the investors should prepare consolidated financial statement, to combine the book of investor, the financial statement of investor, and the financial statement of the investor. They combine those two financial statement, and it will be discussed in the next course, which is Advanced Accounting 1. One semester, the whole semester, we will talk about consolidated financial statement.
Okay, in your book, Illustration 1721 summarize the investment accounting approaches that we already discussed, and I think the table is quite straightforward. So please have time to read the book. Now we turn to the last section of this chapter, which is impairment. As you may learn, as you have learned in chapter 11, Intermediate Accounting 1, there is a phrase called impairment. We do impairment for fixed asset and also intangible asset. And actually, for every asset, we have to do this impairment test. Also in inventory, we do impairment test for the inventory by checking, by comparing the cost versus the net realizable value. It is part of impairment. So all assets, principally, all assets are subject to impairment test. Okay, what is impairment? Impairment is actually a loss that we recognize when the fair value of the asset is lower than the cost or the carrying value of the asset. Jadi impairment ini dicatat ketika fair value asset turun di bawah carrying value. Okay. And this impairment of value is relevant only for non-fair value method. Jadi impairment of value ini hanya dipakai untuk non-fair value method. Karena di fair value method, any decrease of fair value consider impairment. Kita catat sebagai penurunan penyesuaian nilai wajar.
Okay. So a company should evaluate every debt investment accounted for at amortized cost at each reporting date to determine if it has suffered impairment, a loss in value such that the fair value of the investment below its carrying value. If the company determines that an investment is impaired, and the company should write down the amortized cost basis of the individual security to reflect this loss in value. Jadi kalau tadi kan saya bilang ya, impairment ini not for fair value method. Generally tidak dipakai. Karena untuk fair value method, naik dan turunnya fair value itu sudah merefleksikan impairment. Tapi kalau kita pakai amortized cost as I explained you last week, which is another side of what you learn in chapter 14. Di chapter 14 Anda belajar amortized cost versinya debitur, si yang punya utang. Nah di chapter 16 dan maaf di chapter 17 Anda belajar amortized cost dari posisinya
kreditur, si yang membeli obligasi. Amortized cost itu tidak pakai fair value, maka dia subject to impairment test. Ya, sehingga if there is an impairment incident, ya harus di write down investment value-nya, harus diturunkan. Okay, let's see this example. The bond purchased at par for 200,000, and then the investment has 4-year tenor. The coupon is 10%. Okay, and this is the contractual cash flow expected from the asset, ya kan? Dia punya total proceeds-nya atau total face value-nya is 200,000 with interest of 10%. Now, due to some financial difficulties, the debtor, the issuer, cannot pay 20,000 coupon, and the best cash flow that we can receive from the debtor or from the investee or from the issuer of the bond is only 16,000. So there is an impairment in this case. So previously we record the investment as par value, ya, 200,000. Tapi karena ada perubahan cash flow akibat kesulitan ekonomi dan lain-lain, then we have to revise, kan? So we have to calculate the new present value. Kita harus hitung present value baru menggunakan estimasi kas yang baru. Previously we used 20,000 as an interest, and now we have to use this 16,000. Jadi kita harus hitung present value yang baru. Present value of the 200,000 and present value of the annual interest payment. So according to this new scenario, the value of the bonds is 187,000. So we're gonna record around 12,000 impairment loss. Okay, then we debit loss on impairment and credit allowance for impaired investment. Seperti penyisihan piutang tagih, ya, apa namanya, situasinya seperti itu. So we use allowance for impairment untuk mencatat kejadian impairment ini. If subsequently the impairment loss decrease, kalau kemudian impairmentnya decrease karena perbaikan kondisi perekonomian, some or all of the previously recognized impairment loss shall be reversed. Ya, harus dibalik gitu ketika situasinya sudah membaik. So we debit the allowance and we credit recovery of impairment loss, and the reversal of impairment loss shall not result in a carrying amount of the investment that exceed the amortized cost. Intinya, pemulihan impairment loss tidak boleh melampaui impairment loss sebelumnya. So if previously we record loss on impairment for 12,680, so the reversal of impairment loss cannot exceed this 12,680. Ini nggak boleh lama, nggak boleh melebihi. Misalkan terjadi perbaikan, ya kita hanya bisa maksimum sebesar impairment loss that previously recorded. Kita recover. Okay. So what will be okay, last week we also talked about this the second approach, which is get investment not for trading. Jadi kita pegang bonds tapi tidak untuk trading, tidak juga untuk ditunggu sampai jatuh tempo, tapi ini metode kedua yang tempo hari kita bicarakan last week, which is held for collection and selling. Minggu lalu kita juga sudah tahu bahwa for this second approach, HFCS, we have to maintain the amortized cost method, plus in the end of each reporting date, we adjust the fair value of the investment. And the adjustment, the fair value adjustment, the unrealized gain or loss, reported as part of the other comprehensive income, which is equity section. Minggu lalu kita bicara itu. So kalau begitu, ada dua hal yang terjadi di sini. First, the impairment of the investment due to the credit risk, and also the fair value adjustment from the market mechanism. Jadi ada dua hal yang harus diantisipasi ya. Yang pertama, the credit risk, resiko kredit dari debitur, ini kan bisa menciptakan impairment. As you may see in the previous example, the coupon is set previously at 20,000 per year, and due to the economic situation, bad economic condition of the firm, then they can only pay 16,000. So it is part of credit risk. Okay. Another challenge for this investment is market risk. Jadi kondisi demand and supply from the market. It is not from the credit risk of the debt issuer, but it is purely from the market mechanism. Jadi kalau ini obligasi bonds-nya diperdagangkan di pasar, kadang di pasar itu ada situasi yang membuat harga pasar bonds-nya turun atau naik, tapi tidak relate dengan credit risk dari penerbit obligasinya. Credit risk-nya sih baik-baik saja, tapi karena mekanisme perdagangan di pasar membuat misalkan fair value of these bonds changes. Ya, mungkin ada situasi politik, ekonomi, isu yang membuat sentimen di market player changes, then they can change their demand and the supply of the investment, lalu kemudian ada perubahan fair value yang itu tidak mencerminkan credit risk dari si issuer of the bond. Jadi ada dua hal yang harus dihandle. Last week we also talked about this class memegang investment untuk help for collection and also selling. Itu memang susah karena kita harus maintain the amortized cost and also the fair value method. Kita harus combine dua-duanya. Ya karena ini mix. Karena ini mix antara amortized cost di kelompok pertama dengan trading di kelompok ketiga. Di mix di sini ya, artinya harus ada dua metode yang jalan, dua resiko yang dihadapi, credit risk and also the market risk as well. So, let's see this example. The investment purchase for 1 million and the coupon is 7% the fair value of investment has declined to 960,000 due to an increase in market rate. So it is not from the side of issuer. Ini bukan problemnya issuer, tapi problemnya market. Okay. So then when the investment purchase, we record that investment. Okay. When the investors receive interest revenue, record it as this. And due to the changes of the fair value, we record the unrealized holding gain or loss and fair value adjustment. And then this 40 is part of other comprehensive income. Dan di akhir tahun, we close this unrealized holding gain or loss sebagai bagian dari accumulated other comprehensive income. So in the financial statement, we see this account. And now, what if there are, as I told you in the previous slide, holding this kind of investment, which is HFCS, yeah, ini Anda menghadapi dua risiko. First, risiko kredit dari debiturnya dan risiko market. So in this case, these two risks happen. First, a change of 10,000 due to the market rate changes and 30,000 loss due to the credit risk, which is the reputation of the performance of the debtor. Okay, semakin kompleks. So in this case, the third entry in illustration 1724 changes because the impairment loss 30,000 is reported in the income statement, not in other comprehensive income. Okay, the entries will be like this. So first, we debit loss on impairment due to the credit risk. And we also debit unrealized gain due to the market risk. Sorry, unrealized loss due to the market risk. And for the 30,000 impairment, we record in allowance for impairment, and the 10,000 recorded as fair value adjustment. Yang ditutup ke accumulated other comprehensive income hanya yang 10.000, sedangkan loss on impairment recorded as part of profit loss atau net income. Okay. So bagaimana kalau dijual investmentnya, then you receive the cash, kemudian that investment yang previously recorded sebesar 1 million juga dilepas. And then the allowance of the impairment dilepas. Ini seperti menutup piutang. Kalau piutang ditutup, itu allowance-nya juga ikut ditutup. Allowance for bad debt-nya itu. So in this example, we have to close the allowance. Jadi kerugian dari penjualan is only 10,000. Ya, karena yang 30 udah diakui kerugian juga, cuma namanya impairment. Ya. And the actual economic loss sebenarnya juga 40, ya. 10,000 reported as loss on sale and the rest 30,000 reported as okay, and what about the fair value adjustment? So let me think about this, yeah. Jadi yang Bentar. Kita tadi, ingat ya, kita tadi punya simpanan fair value adjustment 10.000. Ya kan? Kita punya simpanan fair value adjustment 10.000 di mana tadi? Ah, di sini. Di jurnal pertama. Oke. Nah, ketika si aset ini dilepas, fair value adjustment ini kan nggak punya pasangan, investasinya dijual. Nah, fair value adjustment yang nggak punya pasangan ini diapakan, Pak? Ini temennya sudah nggak ada ini. As I told you, if we sell fixed asset, we have to write off the related accumulated depreciation. Sama dengan ini, asetnya sekarang dijual. Nah, fair value adjustment-nya dikemanakan? So in this case, the fair value adjustment should be written off, and we put that fair value adjustment, we close that fair value adjustment to the accumulated comprehensive income. Ini menjawab pertanyaan saya dari awal tadi. Loh Pak, ini fair value adjustment-nya kok ikut ditutup ketika asetnya dijual. Tapi di awal tadi waktu kita belajar tentang menjual aset ekuitas, fair value adjustment-nya kok nggak dilepas. Karena tadi fair value adjustment-nya itu nempel di portfolio level, di group level, tidak di individual level. Sedangkan di sini fair value adjustment-nya nempel di individual account, yaitu investasi di siapa ini tadi investinya? Si Hawthorne, siapa tadi investinya. Jadi individual level kalau di sini. Sehingga ketika ini di-treat sebagai individual level, then Anda bisa, dan sebaiknya seharusnya, melepas fair value adjustment, menghapus fair value adjustment when you sell the investment, this individual investment. Semoga ngerti ya penjelasan saya, karena ini individual nih. Ada investment, ada fair value adjustment. Ketika di, jadi di sini fair value adjustment-nya ada di dalam investment. Ketika investment-nya dilepas, yang 1 juta ini dilepas, maka fair value adjustment-nya juga ikut terlepas. Agak rumit memang accounting for investment ini. And as I told you last week, this is the most difficult accounting standard so far. It's too complex, ya. Sangat kompleks. Oke. Okay. What happens if Alexander decide to keep and not to sell, to keep its debt investment and later determines that its credit risk on the investment has decreased by 15,000. Jadi bagaimana kalau kredit risknya yang sebelumnya 30.000 ya, sekarang udah pulih, udah baikkan nih kondisi perusahaan investi, penerbit obligasi, they are getting better, so we have an opportunity to to recover the previous impairment loss. Nah, impairment loss-nya kan sebelumnya 30.000, sekarang kalau nggak jadi dijual tapi impairment loss-nya pulih, ya kita boleh melakukan pemulihan dengan racun. Oke. Actually, there is still one more issue, which is recycling adjustment. Tapi recycling adjustment ini uh, Okay, gini. Let me tell you in bahasa, as this is more, it's too complex. Saya bisa menjelaskan dalam bahasa Inggris, tapi saya takut Anda tidak. Seperti tadi saya jelaskan, ketika kita menjual investasi ekuitas yang dicatat di OCI, lalu aset itu dijual, boleh nggak Pak, keuntungan unrealized gain-nya yang selama ini disimpan di equity, di accumulated other comprehensive income. Sekarang kan sudah saya jual nih Pak asetnya. Boleh nggak ini saya pindah ke retained earnings? So, we are talking about moving the accumulated other comprehensive income into retained earnings. Nah, kita lihat sebentar saja ya, karena isunya ini sangat kompleks. Ada yang tidak boleh sama sekali di recycle, ada yang masih boleh di recycle. Hanya saja buku ini tidak cukup detail untuk menjelaskan itu. Let's see this example. Jadi ada investment HFCS, berarti ini debt investment, investasi utang, tapi diperlakukan pakai metode kedua, mixed method, yaitu HFCS, held for collection sekaligus for selling. Kemudian assume that on January 1st, Inks had cash and share capital 50 at that date. Jadi dia punya cash di balance sheet-nya, dia juga punya equity di share capital di bagian equity. Jadi dia punya cash 50, dia punya share capital 50 di balance sheet atau financial position-nya. And at that date, the company had no other asset liability or equity. Ini kosong nih, masih mulai baru pertama, ya. Nggak punya apa-apa, punyanya cuma itu. And then on January, Inks membeli 50 debt securities yang dicatat sebagai HFCS, bukan trading, bukan amortized cost. Oke. Okay. Maka sekarang neracanya berubah dong dari bentuk seperti ini, posisinya bukannya, bukan bentuknya, posisinya. Dia punya tetap stock capital atau share capitalnya sebesar 50, cuman nggak punya cash lagi, cashnya zero, menjadi debt investment 50. Okay. Still balance, still okay. Nah, on June 30, posisi financial statement awalnya, perhatikan, awalnya dia punya debt investment 50 and share capital 50. On June 30, Inks menjual part of this security dan mencatatkan gain dari penjualan sebesar 2.000, realized gain. Oke. Apa yang terjadi pada laporan posisi keuangan? So, karena dijual, maka perusahaan punya cash sekarang, which is 22, ya kan? Debt investment-nya dijual berapa ini? 20, jadi tinggal 30 yang awalnya 50 ya. Kemudian equity, share capital tetap 50. Karena ini realized gain ini masuk ke net income, maka dicatat sebagai retained earning 2. Oke. Okay? everything is still balanced, still okay. Nah, kita ngerti nih, ini keuntungan penjualan memang tempatnya di retained earning. Then we put these $2,000 in the retained earnings. Nah, Hinks did not purchase or sell any other securities during 2019. It received 3,000 interest during the year. Okay, tambah interest. Berarti ada net income baru ya, plus interest. Okay. Then cash-nya juga menjadi 25 ya. 25. Tambah 3 cash. At December 31st, 2019, the remaining portfolio, which is 30,000, punya keuntungan fair value 4,000. Okay. And as I told you, this HFCS treat the unrealized gain not part of the net income, tapi part of the accumulated other comprehensive income. Kan ya, ini OCI. Okay. In the end of the year, Hinks melaporkan laba rugi, interest revenue tadi 3,000, 2,000 keuntungan penjualan, so the total realized gain adalah 5,000. Lalu di bawah net income ada statement of comprehensive income, di sana ditunjukkan adanya unrealized gain dari valuation adjustment sebelumnya 4,000. Jadi total comprehensive income 9,000 ya, 5 ditambah 4, 9. Oke. Okay. Ini panjang. Memang harus detail, rinci. Nah, di laporan perubahan modal, saldo ekuitas 50, kemudian retained earning 5,000, accumulated other comprehensive income 4,000. Ya kan, 5,000 dari si siapa tadi? Interest dan keuntungan penjualannya. 4,000 dari penyesuaian evaluasi, penyesuaian nilai wajar. Lalu kita buat komparasi awal tahun dan akhir tahun seperti bisa dilihat di sini. Oke, tidak ada yang istimewa. Nah, persoalannya adalah pada 4,000 itu, kapan 4,000 itu pindah menjadi retained earning? This is what we call as recycle issue. 4,000 itu akan tetap di situ, or they have a chance to become retained earnings. When a company sells securities during the year, global counting of the realized gain or loss in comprehensive income can occur. Ya, kalau kenapa bisa terjadi ya? Karena ini si 4,000 sudah pernah dicatat sebagai ini tadi keuntungan atau keuntungan sudah pernah dicatat sebagai keuntungan. Oke. Okay. Cost dari investmentnya ini saya masih menjelaskan yang ini tadi ya. Saya menjelaskannya. Kenapa kok bisa terjadi double counting? Karena unrealized gain-nya masih ada 4,000. Kalau ini nanti dijual dengan gain, lalu pembandingnya adalah cost. Cost-nya berapa tadi? Cost-nya 30. Kemudian kalau misalkan dijual dengan price 36, oh dicatat keuntungan 6,000. Hey, harus hati-hati, hati-hati. Kenapa? Inimu yang salah, inimu 30. Nah, 4.000 sudah pernah dicatat, seharusnya ini 34 dong. Jadi kamu cuma mengakui keuntungan 2.000. Kalau kamu mengakui keuntungan 6.000, itu double counting keuntunganmu. Akhirnya secara total keuntunganmu seolah-olah 10.000. 4.000 dari unrealized previous year, 6.000 dari hasil penjualan. Nah, itu masalah gitu. Mana solusinya? Read your book ya. Read your book. Jadi itu karena unrealized gain or loss-nya ada di OCI, ada di ekuitas. Sedangkan gain dari penjualannya ada di net income. Nah, artinya kawan-kawan, 6.000 boleh dicatat dengan atau 6.000 boleh diakui keuntungan. Tapi yang 4.000 tersimpan di ekuitas itu harus dihilangkan. Kira-kira gitu, di recycle. Nah, contoh. Ini ada sekuritas dengan total gain portofolionya adalah 40.000, unrealized gain portofolio 40.000 ya. Sudah ya, 40.000 taruh di ekuitas ya. Sudah kita ingat di situ. Kemudian, kita buat laporan rugi komprehensif di bagian bawah ada 40.000 keuntungan penyesuaian nilai wajar. Nah, lantas kalau kemudian closing-nya pasti ke accumulated other comprehensive income. Nah, tadi kan kita punya dua saham. Lehman sama Wood. Sekarang coba yang dua obligasi, Lehman sama Wood. Kalau sekarang Lehman itu kita jual 105 dengan keuntungan 105. Maka kita terima kas 105, kemudian investmentnya 80. Nah, masalahnya itu di 80 ini. 80 itu kos. Ini loh kos, 80. Padahal dia sudah pernah naik nilainya 105. Dan 105 ini, si 25 keuntungan ini, disimpannya di ekuitas ya, di other comprehensive income. Nah, ini gain on sale-nya 25. Ini ditaruh di laba rugi, itu double counting. 40.000 masuk ekuitas sebagai penambah accumulated other comprehensive income. 40.000 ini dicatat membuat portofolio naik nilainya. Setelah naik, portofolio dijual, masih ngakui keuntungan. Inilah keberatan saya sejak awal. Ya salahmu sendiri, debt investment-nya dicatat 80, kok dari awal enggak 80, tapi 105. Jadi ketika kita bikin adjustment di sini, kita bikin adjustment di sini. Ini kan kita keep cost-nya 80. Terus keuntungan 25. Kalau saya personal, itu enggak pakai fair value adjustment, langsung debit investment-nya. Sehingga angka 80 ini, kalau saya ya, 80 ini saya debit dengan 25, maka fair value dia langsung menjadi 105. Ketika dijual 105, tidak ada lagi keuntungan penjualan, kan? Ya toh. Jadi ini 80. Terus berubah jadi 105. 25-nya tidak segera diakui, disimpan di ekuitas. Si investment tetap 80. Ketika dijual 105, ada keuntungan seolah-olah ada keuntungan 25. Itu salah. 25 itu nil keuntungan penyesuaian nilai wajar. Bukan keuntungan penjualan. Itu kritik saya terhadap metodenya Pak Kieso ini yang bikin pusing. Tapi Pak Kieso milih cara berliku-liku, ya sudah. Akhirnya kan Pak Kieso mentok sendiri. Ya, terus saya harus apakan itu dengan, karena dia masih keep the value of investment-nya tetap 80, salahnya yang di situ. Coba itu diganti 105 sejak awal. Waktu bikin penyesuaian lagi. Tapi konsekuensinya kalau ngikuti saran saya, manajemennya harus manajemen per individual instrumen. Tidak per portofolio, ya kan? Si keuntungan 40.000 itu kan di level portofolio. 25 dari si Lehman, yang 15 dari si Wu. Nah, oke. Okay. Jadi double counting-nya muncul di situ. Terus solusinya gimana, Pak? Sudah ada keuntungan 40, tambah lagi keuntungan 25. Seolah-olah keuntungannya banyak. Nah, terus dibuatlah, ya, karena Pak Yesu bingung diapakan ya, untuk menghindari double counting itu. Sebentar. Ya, seharusnya ini sayangnya tidak dijelaskan dengan baik oleh Pak Yesu. Seharusnya ketika mencatat jurnal yang terakhir itu, gain on sale-nya itu bisa diganti, tidak 25, gain on sale-nya itu tidak dicatat gain on sale, tapi akun ini diganti saja, yaitu merecycle accumulated other comprehensive income, dipindah ke retained earning, yang 25 itu. Jadi, kita enggak ada keuntungan. Jadi sejak awal debt investment-nya dicatat 105. Itu kalau saran saya. Kalau sarannya Pak Kieso, muter-muter enggak jelas. Sebelum sampai ke saran itu Pak Kieso ngasih pengecoh dulu untuk memperjelas posisinya yang menurut saya justru untuk memperumit masalah. Oke. Karena dijual. At the end of 2019, the fair value of the wood bond increased an additional 20. Misalkan si wood yang masih dipegang ini fair value-nya naik menjadi 155, sehingga unrealized gain-nya sekarang 35. So pada portfolio level kita seharusnya punya unrealized gain 35. Sedangkan previous fair value adjustment-nya adalah 40. Nah, untuk membuat fair value adjustment-nya menjadi 35, jadi fair value adjustment-nya harus diturunkan 5.000. Maka dibuatlah jurnal unrealized holding gain or loss 5.000. Lantas di laporan laba rugi dari penjualan obligasinya Lehman tadi dicatat keuntungan 25.000 masuk di situ, masuk ke dalam total net income 720 misalnya. Kemudian OCI dari penyesuaian obligasinya si Wood adalah 5.000, ya masih oke, okay, ya. Nah, kemudian yang 5.000 ini di closing, ditutup ke accumulated other comprehensive income. Nah, saudara sekalian, terjadi kekisruhan di fair value adjustment di other comprehensive income seperti yang saya jelaskan tadi untuk saham yang dijual, yaitu untuk saham si Lehman. Setelah diakui keuntungan penyesuaian nilai wajar 25, terus dijual menjadi realized gain 25, jadi ngakui keuntungannya double, maka harus dibuat apa namanya catatan atas laporan keuangan, yaitu comprehensive income akibat penyesuaian nilai wajar yang pertama. Oke. Ini harus direklas, dipindah, dikeluarkan dari other comprehensive income. Oke. Dipindah, dikeluarkan dari other comprehensive income, masuk ke retained earnings. Cuman oleh Pak Kieso. Pak Kieso nggak tega menampilkan debit OCI, credit retained earning. Dia cuma ngasih, ya ini di recycle gitu saja. Gimana jurnal recycle-nya Pak? Oleh Pak Kieso nggak ditunjukkan. Ini tadi biang keroknya apa keributan ini? Biang keroknya adalah di sini, di 40.000 yang pertama. Karena dicatat pada level portofolio. Coba kamu perlakukan itu sebagai individual account. Itu yang 80.000 naik menjadi 105. Langsung saja debit investasi, kredit unrealized gain. 25 selesai. Unrealized gain 25 dilaporkan sebagai bagian dari ekuitas OCI. Selesai. Begitu investasi dijual 105, ya akui kas 105 di debit. Jadi ini kalau saya loh ya, untuk menghindari keruwetan ini. Makanya dari awal saya sudah menentang metode ini karena ruwet pasti. Jadi kalau saya untuk 80 ini saya akan catat gini, debit investment, credit unrealized gain. Ini masuk OCI. Tetap OCI. Berapa ini? 25. Begitu investmentnya dijual, saya catat debit kas 105, maaf. Credit investment 105. Udah selesai, nggak ada gain. Nah, karena ini sudah dilepas asetnya, maka unrealized gain yang masuk kelompok OCI sudah lepas, dia dipindah ke retained earning. Itu aja, tinggal dari AOCI dipindah ke retained earning. Berapa itu? 25. Kok dipindah Pak? Ini asetnya sudah terjual, sudah jadi keuntungan yang faktual, ada kasnya masuk. Udah, kalau saya begini, lebih ramping, lebih sederhana. Tapi konsekuensi dari metode saya ini, Anda harus memperlakukan setiap akun investasi itu secara individual. Jadi seperti ada piutang sebagai general ledger, kemudian ada subsidiary ledger untuk nama-nama pelanggan Anda kan. Nah, ini sama sebenarnya. Harus punya subsidiary ledger untuk setiap investi yang Anda pegang. Nah, cuman kan membuat subsidiary ledger itu secara teknik accounting, teknologi, dan lain-lain tidak lampah. Jadi dibuat cara gampang diperlakukan pada level portofolio, tapi karena memilih cara gampang, pasti ada cost-nya. Cost-nya adalah keruwetan di belakang, terjadi double counting. yaitu di sini ini 25 menambah ekuitas melalui OCI, 25 menambah retained earning melalui keuntungan penjualan. Nah, resiko juga, cara mana yang Anda pakai? Oke, okay, I will stop at this point. It's too complicated, it's too hard to digest if you want to understand clearly now. I think it's very difficult, but anyway, this is the fact that accounting standard is not perfect. Accounting standard is not perfect. Accounting standard is based on debate, jadi berbasis debat, ya akan selalu begitu. Tapi sebagai reporting entity, we have to follow accounting standard. No choice, ya, no choice.